On the profile interview segment this week, I spoke with Comrade Governor Adams Oshiomole. He shares with me the struggles, the pains, the sources, and perhaps the failure of the movement. He spoke to me about what it was like being the fourth NLC president. And I must tell you, it was an engaging, informative, and interesting conversation. Take a listen. You're welcome to the program.
My pleasure.
Shalom. A lot has been said about the Nigerian Labour Congress, yes. And it's celebrating its 40th anniversary. What's your take on it?
I think for several reasons. 40 years of unorganized labour, talking about a mass movement in the entire black world, NLC is the largest non-governmental, membership-driven, membership-funded organization in the black world. And so to survive 40 years, and during this period, NLC had its own fair share of military abuse of power. Two or three times it was dissolved by successive military governments, and it outlived those governments. And even other civilian administration, other president of Obasanjo, there was a bill to the House in which the president wanted NLC to be deregistered, and we fought back. And of course, they succeeded in creating TUC out of that. And but again, the TUC has since found common grounds to work in harmony and in unity, and wherever it matters, in unison, to deal with all of those issues that affect the world of work, and indeed matters affecting workers and working families. So I think for several reasons, NLC has, you know, it's entitled to this celebration.
You were the president of the Nigerian Labour Congress between February 1999 to February 2007.
Correct.
What would you say are your achievements?
It is not for me to, you know, score myself. I would be more comfortable if people were to play back the NLC role in the Nigeria polity, economy, and society during those period, and form opinion about my role, you know, what the NLC was under my leadership. That will offer me more comfort than asking me what I think. But I think that, first, beginning with the unity of the NLC, which the then president wanted to undermine by proposing a legislation to which expressly, among other things, provided for the deregistration of the NLC. And I remember people saying I should go and plead with the president not to dissolve the NLC. And I said, no, NLC will not bow before presidents. NLC will stand on its feet. It will fight, either win or lose, but on its feet. I won't, other NLC, other my leadership, we'll go on our knees to plead with any administration. And I submitted that the future and the unity of the movement was not at the pleasure of the president of the day, and that NLC will outlive President Obasanjo's government. And it is history. So that for me is something. I also believe that we sufficiently moderated the then president not to do some of the things that, in our judgment, were going to grossly erode the working, the living standard of workers and indeed working families. And we engage him on all of those issues. We also engage him on issues that has to do with democratic principles. And perhaps the best way to measure whether these engagements meant anything is to play back the national broadcast of President Obasanjo, where he accused me and said Oshiomole was behaving as alternate president and the NLC was behaving like a parallel government. Now, when a president makes a national broadcast like that, more or less accusing me of treason, it shows the amount of discomfort that we have created for him. And for me, that summarizes the extent to which we were able to speak, not just speak truth to power, or back, but also to bite wherever it was necessary. And it goes beyond the one that people often talk about. Mm-hmm. Of course, we raised the minimum wage from, as it then was, 2,200 naira or so to 5,500 by law. And through negotiation, we got the federal government to adopt 7,500 naira minimum wage, and the oil producing states to have the same 7,500 minimum wage, and the other states from between 6,000 to 7,000 across the country. Now, by today's standard, that doesn't make much sense, but when you recognize that we increase the figure from 2,200 or 2,500 to those numbers, you are talking about between 100 and 200% increase.
Which moves me to my next question. You're known to actively engage the government and the workers effectively. I would like to ask you, what do you think, what does it actually take to ensure that we have a vibrant labor union by ensuring that there's active engagement between the government and the workers?
For me, more than anybody else in society, the union man has to be sharp. He has to be grounded in everything. He has to be jack of all trade and master of all, because the issues you confront ranges, covers the economy, the polity, and society. And you must be able to engage convincingly, because we are persuading followers to decide who to believe. Because don't forget, as much as workers are members of trade unions, they are also, some of them, members of political parties. And indeed, they also can tell you, and it is a fact, that they did vote for these governments, whether at the federal, state, or local government level. So just the same way as they voted for you through a direct election to become the president of their own movement. So when you engage the government, which they participate in electing, you have to convince them that what the government is doing is wrong, and that what you're asking them to do is right, and that your own solutions or suggestions as to policy options are doable, and that they will be more beneficial. How they resolve that, who they choose to believe, determine at the end of the day the strength of trade unions. Because if people don't follow your action, you threaten, and it doesn't come to pass, your threat lose potency, and over time, government would listen, no employers will listen.
Okay, talking about credibility, I would like to ask you, I've learned so far that most times getting credible leaders starts from the academics. That is, it starts from the teachers, the lecturers, to students, then it comes out as a total package. So I would like to ask you, how would you rate the education sector in Nigeria? And how do you think instilling the right discipline and principles of survival for an average worker should be instilled in students?
You really don't know anyone until you are trusting with power. There are no scientific instrument to read a man or a woman and say, he will be like this. So until you give him power, you really don't know who he or she is. We've seen it here. Everybody seems to be an angel until he's challenged with certain realities and certain levels of temptation. How he reacts to those define ultimately his issue of character. But I think the point I was also seeking to make is that in those days when people like Professor Ejega were in the university system, they produce what you might call very progressive student community, that were deep, not just in their field of study. It didn't matter whether they were reading medicine, they were reading pharmacy, engineering, but they were sufficiently exposed to issues around the political economy, radical thoughts, what was going on around the world in Cuba, the difference between the socialist countries and the capitalist countries, the promise of the market system, Karl Marx's critique of capitalism and the socialist alternative. All of those things help to deepen the workers' understanding of the world that they live in. And as they grow up to approach the real world, they have some clarity about alternative possibilities, right? Now, those were the days we talk about Bala Usman brought up in ABU, a very rich left-wing community that were being built and developed by lecturers who themselves were quite knowledgeable and very, very progressive. Now, unfortunately, we do no longer have that kind of thing, which is why the Nigeria Students Union, NAMS, is no longer what it used to be in those days because the breaking ground has been eroded.
I'm actually really concerned about the youths of today and looking at the labor sector. And since you've said knowledge is power and we need to be equipped with what is needed to ensure that we survive in the 21st century, what do you think is the way forward in capturing the young mind?
Yeah, I think that the organized labor should show sufficient interest on matters that have to do with quality of education. And we are not just talking about the university system, important as it is. The foundation, you know, we have in law what you call universal basic education, under which it is compulsory and mandatory for every child of school age to be in school. And yet, in spite of that law, the average of out-of-school population, I think, around the country, national average, might be around maybe 20% or 25%, because in some states it is as high as 50% or more than 50%, while in some other states it's as low as 6%. I think the lowest is Ekiti and Edo State. Ekiti, around 6, Edo about 6.7% out of school. From that bottom, it goes up to 55% out of school population. Now, by the time you interrogate the content and the quality of those schools, you know, if you define a school, it tells of any environment in which there's somebody in front, posing as a teacher, and some little kids behind listening. If that's your definition, then this answer is valid. But if you go to interrogate the quality of the teaching staff and the teaching environment, the quality of the classroom, then the situation becomes even much more frightening. In Edo State, I did try to address this because for me, the way to pay back God's favor in my life is to restore and stretch the ladder that made it possible for me as a small boy born to a very humble family in a typical rural Nigeria, you know, but benefiting from free quality primary education. That was the only foundation I needed to be able to resort to self-help thereafter by way of training and retraining and going to school to further my education and to be able to work and get to the level of, a fatty hand becoming a governor of a state as complex and as sophisticated as Edo State. So education is the key. And anyone who wishes to pay back public debts, you must invest in education. Not rhetoric, not just symbolism, in terms of real content.
Is there any experience you can't forget being the NLC president?
Yes, quite a number. I think there was a day at about 2 a.m. the government decided to remove all the securities in my house, whether they were my own employees or whoever they were, including one or two policemen that were attached to me to protect the house. And one of them just called me and said, "Oga, you are alone now in the house. We have all been withdrawn, even the local megaidi, the gate men, everybody has been taken away. So I suspect that they are about to do something terrible. And they don't want any witnesses." It's about 2 a.m. But fortunately, I had a guy who was living in my guest house. I got down, I checked the gate, I saw that everybody was gone. But this guy in his innocence was the only one sleeping, and my driver. They were fair enough to leave the driver. And I called him, "Tony, now we have to get out of this house." I had to do a couple of things which I can't explain in camera to be able to fool the police and the SSS that had surrounded my house. You know, get them to move, thinking they were chasing me, whereas I wasn't the one, and they find a way to escape from my house. And now the challenge was, having successfully escaped, where do I hide? I was too, as they say, whether it's a goldie fish or it's a silver fish, some kind of fish simply can't hide. And people don't know that you are running away from trouble. They want to announce that you are with them and with excitement, with good attention. And I managed to find where to stay. And I stayed there until the following day morning. I was able to call the NLC to tell them what was happening. And my driver was jacked on the road, stopped. But the police thought I had some magic. They believe I disappeared from the car. And then they started to say, these Benin people, these Edo people. But there was nothing missing. I was just one inch ahead of them.
It's good to have you on the program.
Thank you, Sharon.
And that's all we can take on this edition of Labour Lens. Join us next time for a fresh edition of the show. I am Sharon Ijason. Thanks for watching. And remember, labour creates wealth.